Welcome back everyone, this is Shivani Garg. In this lecture we will be studying the power flow equations under statistics. Let's get started. So consider this circuit here. Consider this circuit. This V1 is the sending end voltage at an angle delta. This V2 is the receiving end voltage. We have considered it as a reference voltage, so angle 0 degree. I is the current flowing through this line. R is the line resistance, and this is the line reactance. So Z is equal to total line impedance is equal to R plus Jx. So from this circuit, current I can be calculated as V1 minus V2 upon Z. If we simplify it, then we get V1 upon Z angle del minus theta minus V2 upon Z angle minus theta. So power at the receiving end is given by T2 is equal to real value of V2 into I conjugate, or we can write it as P2 is equal to real part of V2 into, we can put the value of I from this equation, V1 upon Z angle theta minus delta minus V2 upon Z angle theta. If we simplify it and write the only real part of this equation, we get P2 is equal to V1 V2 upon Z cos theta minus delta minus V2 square upon Z cos theta. Let theta is equal to 90 minus alpha, then P2 is equal to V1 into V2 upon Z cos 90 minus alpha. We put the value of theta in this equation, so we get cos 90 minus alpha minus delta minus V2 square upon Z cos 90 minus alpha. Or if we simplify this equation using trigonometry, we get P2 is equal to V1 V2 upon Z sin alpha plus delta minus V2 square upon Z sin alpha. So as we can see, the value of P2 is this as we have calculated previously, and this is the function of alpha which depends on the impedance of line, and this P2 would be maximum when this positive term would be maximum, and this will be maximum when alpha plus delta is equal to 90 degree or delta is equal to 90 minus alpha. So we put the value of delta in this equation, we get P2 max is equal to V1 V2 upon Z minus V2 square upon Z into sin alpha. Also, as we know that sin alpha is equal to R by Z, since R plus Jx is equal to Z angle theta and theta is 90 minus alpha, so from this we can calculate sin alpha is equal to R by Z. Therefore P2 max would be equal to V1 V2 upon under root of R square plus X square minus V2 square upon under root of R square plus X square into R upon under root of R square plus X square, as Z is the magnitude of this value, which is equal to under root of R square plus X square. And when receiving end voltage is equal to sending end voltage, then P2 max would be equal to V2 square into 1 upon under root of R square plus X square minus R upon R square plus X square. And for P2 max to be maximum, we differentiate this equation with respect to X and put it equal to 0. We get it P2 max upon dx is equal to 0 is equal to V2 square, as it does not depend on X, into differentiation of this equation, we get X upon R square plus X square whole power 3 by 2 minus 2X R upon R square plus X square whole power 2. Or if we simplify this equation, we get V2 square upon X upon R square plus X square whole square into under root of R square plus X square minus 2R is equal to 0. Since from this equation this term cannot be 0, so we put this bracket term is equal to 0 and we get R square plus X square is equal to 4R square. If we further simplify this equation, we get X is equal to under root of 3R. So from this we can say that the maximum power can be transferred from sending end to receiving end when the reactance of the line is root 3 times of its resistance. And normally the reactance is quite large as compared to the resistance. So from the above equation, it is clear that power can be transferred from sending it to receiving it only if reactance is present in the line. If in case reactance X is equal to 0, then P2 would mode also be equal to 0. But for a lossless line, that is when R is equal to 0, the transmitted power can be calculated as P2 is equal to V1 V2 upon X sine delta. From this equation, it shows that the power transmitted depends upon the system reactance X and the angle between the two rotors, that is called power angle delta. And this, the curve drawn between P2 and delta is known as the power angle curve and is shown in this figure. This is the power angle curve, and the power maximum power transfer, that is PM, occurs at when delta is equal to 90 degree and it is equal to PM is equal to V1 V2 upon X. So from the above distribution, we can conclude that the load angle delta is positive for generator action and negative for motor action. In case of generator action, the rotor advances in the direction of rotation, whereas for motor action, the rotor retards or falls back opposite to the direction of rotation, and the system is stable if and only if for an increase in rotor angle delta, the transmitted power also increases, that is dp by d del is equal, should be positive. The range where dp by d del is positive lies between 90 and minus 90 degree, plus 90 to minus 90 degree. Pm is known as the steady state stability limit of the system, which means that it is the maximum power that can be transmitted, and synchronous will be lost if an attempt is made to transmit power more than this limit. So from the previous 5 lectures studied on power system stability, we have some considerations summarized in this slide. The solution of swing equation gives the relation between rotor angle as a function of time, and this relation is plotted in terms of curves. If the curves show that the angle between two machine rotors increases without limit, the system is said to be unstable. On the other hand, if the angle initially increases and then start reducing, it is probable, though not certain, that the system is stable. Many a time in a multi-machine system, one of the machine may stay in step on the first swing and yet go out of step in the subsequent swing. For a two-machine system, under the assumption of constant input, no damping and constant voltage behind transient reactance, the machines either fall out of step in the first swing or never. Under this condition, the two machines are said to be running at standstill with respect to each other. There is a graphical method for determining whether the two machines are running at standstill with respect to each other or not. This method is known as equilibria criteria for stability. So in next lecture, we will be studying the equilibria criteria. Thank you.